The Philippine Senate examines the credibility of the state-run lottery after it drew flak on social media over an edited photo of a winning bettor. The photo showed a winning bettor from Bulacan claiming her jackpot prize on December 28th. In a Senate hearing, the Philippine Charity Sweepstakes Office apologized and admitted they edited the image to protect her identity.
Bakit kailangan i-edit?
We have to protect the identity of the winner. Meron po nagreklamo sa amin one time, we covered the face, eh yung damit naman po ay nakilala. So, nagreklamo siya, sana naman daw po wag ipakita naman po yung damit. So,
Senator Tulfo, meanwhile, wants to verify the names and identity of past lotto winners amid the controversy.
Marami nagtataka, siyempre, especially yung mga mananaya na ang bilis na manalo ngayon sa PCSO, especially na the fact na hindi naman pwedeng sabihin kung sino yung mga nanalo, pwede naman nila itago. Plus, pagdating po dun sa online, sila naman may control ng computer system na yan. So, madali na nilang i-hocus-pocus.
Over now to the push for charter change, a leading advocate of a people's initiative to amend the Philippine Constitution expects it to culminate in a plebiscite by July. RG Cruz reports.
House Ways and Means Committee Chair Joey Salceda, an advocate of charter change, believes the people's initiative to amend the charter will meet the required 12% of signatures of voters nationwide next week, and that it's on track for ratification by July, confirming a timeline previously exposed by Kabataan Party List.
I think most of the country, I think by next week, we must have already achieved the 12%, beyond the 12% of nationals. It's a question of physically submitting it to the local region, Comelec region. We are in that process already. Pervasively, I think 80% of the country is already in that process.
The timeline details the milestones from the gathering of signatures, vetting by the Commission on Elections, all the way to the plebiscite. Salceda is unbothered by the 20 districts where there is difficulty in getting the signatures of the 3%, since there are 60 districts where more than 3% have been gathered. Advocates are careful, though, since missing even just one district will kill the initiative.
The PI is already inevitable. I heard that Marco Wangco is trying to beat 50%. Mian Singson has beaten 30%. There is an attempt to, you know, go beyond, to make up for example, for the slow-moving.
Albay First District Representative Edsel Lagman, however, maintains the signature gathering process is flawed, arguing that verified voters should sign the petition in front of an election register. He hopes the COMELEC will issue the necessary clarification. Salceda believes the House will insist on their version of the amendments to the economic provisions of the Charter, which they approved in the 18th Congress, claiming it has a bigger and better impact on the economy as it amends 7 provisions compared to the 3 sectors in the Senate proposal. Salceda explains the Senate proposal only affects public utilities, education, and advertising, but the House also wants changes to natural resources, land, and mass media ownership.
Yung mga in-open nila, maabot lang ng 2%. Yung in-open ng House, 14% of the entire GDP. So 3.11% versus 15%. So 5 times. So bakit, why go for 3 times? Magbubukas ka nilang, edi buksan mo na lahat.
A public advocacy group, the Foundation for Economic Freedom, agrees removing the constitutional restrictions on foreign ownership will make the country more attractive to foreign investors. The group's president, Calixto Chiquiamco, told ENC it is the right time to make changes, particularly the Filipino-only and Filipino-first provisions. He adds the government's procurement law also needs to be revisited since it is being abused by local businesses.
The government's mandated to award bids to Filipino suppliers even if they're 20% more expensive. So it is being abused to extract rent. Instead of being able to compete.
Meanwhile, Salceda foresees a problem if the House and the Senate cannot agree on the amendments. He doubts a bicameral conference committee can be convened in a charter amendment. He hopes deliberations will instead be joint, even if voting is separate.
I cannot foresee a kind of reconciliation through a bicameral conference committee because that is not provided for as one of the processes of Congress acting as a constituent assembly.
The House's resolution of both houses number 2 in the 18th Congress is among the 358 attempts by lawmakers to change the Constitution since the 18th Congress. Meanwhile, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri says he will resign if political amendments are made to the Constitution.
I rest assure you, wala po tayong political amendments. It will be my political head at stake. So, at least sa amin sa Senado, hindi namin papasingit yan. If there will be a move like that, then I will resign as Senate President.
It's RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
While the Philippine PO body said it has received more signature forms for a people's initiative from about 600 cities and municipalities Thursday. That's up from the 400 they recorded a day earlier. But that number still falls short of the total signatories needed to make the Congress and Senate vote jointly to amend the Constitution. The Philippine government may allow the International Criminal Court to conduct an investigation into the Duterte administration's drug war if legal procedures are followed. That's according to Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla. Speaking to Kyodo News, Remulla said, "There's nothing wrong with the probe if the ICC is not doing anything illegal." But he asserts both sides still need to clarify many issues about the procedures of the investigation. The Philippines withdrew from the ICC in March 2019. But the Hague-based tribunal says it retains jurisdiction over alleged crimes committed while the country was a member from November 2011. President Marcos also did not rule out the possibility of the Philippines rejoining the ICC. China's foreign ministry firing back following stark remarks from Manila's top defense official. Beijing insists it will never accept any provocations on the Taiwan issue as it again accuses the Philippines of seriously violating the One China policy. Beijing's remarks come after Philippine Defense Secretary Gilberto Teodoro slammed Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson Mao Ning for engaging in what he called gutter talk.
The One China principle is the red line and bottom line. China will never accept anyone's provocations on the Taiwan issue and will resolutely fight back. We urge the Philippine side to earnestly abide by the spirit of the China-Philippines joint communique and abide by the One China principle and stop its wrong words and deeds on the Taiwan issue.
Tensions between the Philippines and China entered a new front after President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. congratulated Taiwan's President-elect Lai Ching-te. The move clearly did not sit well with Beijing, as it suggested Marcos should read more to better understand the Taiwan issue. Manila and Beijing vowing to improve communication on maritime issues in the South China Sea. That commitment was made during talks in Shanghai between China's Assistant Foreign Minister Nong Rong and Philippine Foreign Affairs Undersecretary Teresa Lazaro. They agreed maintaining dialogue is essential to maritime peace and stability. Both sides committed to improve communication mechanisms between their foreign ministries and coast guards. The Philippine Space Agency, or PhilSA, warns of Chinese rocket debris that may have fallen over the West Philippine Sea. The debris may pose a danger to vessels passing through the drop zone. PhilSA says these may have fallen some 52 nautical miles from the Bajo de Masinloc and 98 nautical miles from Cabra Island in Occidental Mindoro. The debris is from the Long March rocket. From the Long March 7 rocket that China launched Wednesday from Hainan. The rocket brought essential cargo to the crew on China's Tiangong space station. At least 7 people killed in a landslide that hit a mining area in Davao de Oro. 2 were hurt, while at least 10 others are missing. Authorities in the town of Huancayo have temporarily halted search and rescue efforts due to fears of another landslide. Authorities blame the tragedy on nonstop rains brought about by a shear line weather system.
Before po nangyari iyon, nag-advise na po yung barangay captain doon na mag-evacuate na sila kasi nga parang unti-unti nang nag-landslide doon. Hindi naman po sila nakinig. At saka si Mayor din po, sir, noong January 16 pa, nag-issue na po ng first evacuation.
In Tagum City, Davao del Norte, the national road remains impassable to light vehicles due to floods. Other towns in the province remain submerged in flood waters. The flooding has affected around 46,000 families. Local governments are studying whether to declare a state of calamity. Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Anna Claren. Hi, Anna.
Good morning, Bettina. As of the moment, we're not monitoring any weather disturbance that may affect the country, but the shear line will still affect the eastern section of Visayas and Mindanao, bringing cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms over Caraga and Davao region. Meanwhile, the northeast monsoon still prevailing here in Luzon, bringing cloudy skies with light rains over Cagayan Valley and Aurora. Here in Metro Manila, Ilocos Region, Cordillera Adventist Region, Calabar Zone, Bicol Region, and the rest of Central Luzon, we're expecting a partly cloudy to cloudy skies aside from isolated light rains, while the rest of the country, we're expecting a generally fair weather condition aside from isolated rain showers mostly in the afternoon or in the evening. The temperature range here in Metro Manila is from 22 to 29 degrees Celsius. In Baguio City is from 14 to 23 degrees. And in Tagaytay is 20 to 27 degrees Celsius. And that's the latest from PAGASA. This is Anna Claren. Good morning.
Thank you very much for that update, Anna.